Hello everyone, welcome to another video. Today we'll be exploring the common question of why the night sky is dark, despite there being over 200 billion trillion stars in the universe we know today. This line of reasoning pertains to Olbers' paradox. Why is the night sky dark? This question dates back to 1610, when Kepler reportedly first posed the question, but the paradox and its believed solution would become better attributed to the German astronomer Heinrich Olbers in the 1800s. This question pertains to the fact that our Milky Way galaxy alone contains anywhere from 100 to 400 billion stars, and the observable universe contains approximately 100 to 200 billion galaxies. By this notion, astronomers wondered that since the universe is filled with a seemingly endless number of luminous light-emitting objects in all directions, logically, every sightline from the Earth would eventually intersect with a bright object. This should cause the night sky to be uniformly bright in all directions, lighting up the universe to as bright as the sun appears on a sunny day. This is not the case, however, which puzzled astronomers. As would later be discovered, this conclusion was drawn from several false assumptions about the nature of the cosmos that we have corrected today. Stemming from a time when the steady-state theory was the most widely accepted viewpoint on the universe, astronomers thought that the universe was of an infinite age, infinite size, uniform in all directions, and not expanding. The cosmos was thought to be completely stagnant and absolute, to which, as we have explored previously, we know this isn't the case. Today, we view the cosmos as having a finite beginning and a finite size that is expanding from the Big Bang that started it all. What does this mean, though, in terms of our universe being dark? Well, let's take a look at one of the properties of light and luminous objects in outer space. To our benefit of understanding, the brightness of distant light-emitting objects depends on a fairly simple equation in which the brightness is proportional to the distance squared. Another way to interpret this is, if you double the distance an object is away from you, that object will appear 1/4 as bright as it used to be. The speed of light is also finite, holding the universe to the cosmological speed limit of 299,792,458 meters per second, meaning waves of light emitted from any sort of luminous object do not reach your eyes instantaneously, but takes a relatively long time when zooming out across the cosmos. The light emitted from the sun takes roughly 8 minutes to reach our eyes, whereas we know there are stars that are millions or even billions of light years away. One of the farthest stars away from Earth that we've been able to see with the James Webb Space Telescope is Arendal, which takes 12.9 billion years for its light to reach our planet. This is a time and distance so far away that the star's light has close to zero effects in terms of the brightness of our night sky, to which there are billions of more stars in situations just like this. Another point to note is that the universe is expanding at an accelerating rate today, which means that it is more difficult for light to reach us, let alone at the same intensity in which it first began its journey. The expansion of our universe disperses light, matter, and energy further and further away from us, creating an edge to our visibility of the universe, to beyond which is so far away that we will never be able to see nor travel to distances in our universe, even if we had the technology to travel at the speed of light. Otherwise known as the cosmic horizon, This means that although the universe may or may not be infinite in its actual size, what is visible to us in the sense of the visible universe is finite. The expansion of our universe continues to push more and more matter out of our reaches forever, leaving less luminous objects to potentially light up our night sky. One common misconception on why the night sky is dark is the thought that the presence of dust, rock, and other non-luminous objects block out the light of distant stars to make them appear fainter. This is not true, however, because not only is light capable of bending around said objects to continue in its trajectory, but also in the case of dust, dust is able to absorb energy. In absorbing energy from photons, the dust would simply heat up and re-radiate said energy as light again, meaning dust wouldn't inhibit the path of light whatsoever. Instead, dust would merely be an added medium between the path of light. Despite everything we've gathered on this topic so far, this still isn't enough to explain why our night sky isn't lit up as if it were daytime. The final part of this explanation ties back to the Big Bang Theory and what it infers that differs from the steady-state theory. This happens to be that the universe has a finite age, a beginning in which tells us that although the night sky could become bright under certain circumstances trillions of years in the future, our universe is simply not old enough for light to have circumnavigated the cosmos in the capacity that would be necessary for a bright universe. And it likely never will. Although the universe is full of an unfathomable number of stars and indescribably bright cosmic events, even these are finite. Stars have a definite beginning and a definite end. Eventually, stars run out of fuel and cease to contribute to lighting up this dark and largely empty cosmos. In a seemingly infinite passing of time, this universe which began in darkness will end shrouded in darkness too, but we'll save that for another video. Thank you all for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please consider liking and hitting that subscribe button with the notification bell on. To learn more about Olbers' paradox and why the night sky is dark, see the links to the research I use for this video in the description. If there are other ideas you'd like to see covered in a future video, please leave it in the comments below. A special shout out to Steve and GRIECO, who composed the intro music you heard in the beginning of this video. Please make sure to check out other amazing music and albums he has composed, as linked in the description below. Have a great day, everyone, and remember to stay curious.